Hello, it's Marion here, and I'm sorry I can't be with you this evening. But please, can I say a heartfelt, I can't tell you how heartfelt, thank you to all of the booksellers who sold so many of Again Rachel in the last 3 months, and to everyone in the media, and book reviewers, bloggers, you know, for supporting Again Rachel, like, with such love. And I mean, it hasn't just been Again Rachel, like, it's been over the last 27 years from my very first book. You've always supported me, and I am immensely grateful, and I never take it for granted. Thank you so, so much.
Soto is back is the story of Kerry Soto, who is the number one tennis player in the world when she retires. But it's not 1989 anymore when she retires, it is 1994, and her rival Nicky Chan has now matched her Grand Slam record. And so Kerry decides to come out of retirement and announces that she will play all four Grand Slams in order to take back her record. This story is one of the most fun experiences I have ever had writing a book. And Kerry Soto, both as a person and as a story, stands for a lot of things that are very important to me. But right now, I think the thing that excites me the most about sharing it is that it is fun. I think the world is a wild and often dreary place these days, and I want to offer something to readers that will bring them joy and will be a breath of fresh air. And I am very much hoping that Kerry Soto can do that.
Hello Ireland, the whole of Ireland, it's Richard Osman here. Just wanted to introduce you to my new novel, which is called The Bullet That Missed. It's out in September. It's the further adventures of the Thursday Murder Club. If you like those two, you'll love it. If you dislike those two, you probably won't like it, but listen, that's moot, isn't it? I've received such support from Ireland, I really, really do, and I can't wait to come back over there again, meet all the readers, meet all the booksellers, but your support is essential and genuinely appreciated. So The Bullet That Missed, it's about a local news anchor who has a case for the Thursday Murder Club, so I get to write a little bit about TV as well. There's even a scene in a daytime quiz show. Where do I get my ideas from? I hope you absolutely love it, and I look forward to seeing all of you very, very soon.
Stroud, and thank you for everything that you do for readers everywhere. And also thank you for giving me this chance to talk just briefly about my new book, Lucy by the Sea. As we know, the world changed in the spring of 2020. And I had just gotten done writing O. William. So I was thinking about Lucy and I was still thinking about William. And I always think about Bob Burgess. And all of a sudden I realized, wait a minute, let's get Lucy out of New York City. William will take her. So William and Lucy left New York City, as did 7% of the population of Manhattan at that time. So William takes Lucy up to Maine, and there they are stuck with each other in a cottage on the cliff by the sea. And many things happen to them personally and to those around them, and I really hope you enjoy the book. Thank you.
When I was 15 years old, I was introduced to the work of Primo Levi and Elie Wiesel, and a lifelong interest in the study of the Holocaust began. For two decades, I read widely on the subject, and one day, this led me to write a novel called The Boy in the Striped Pajamas, which changed my life entirely. That book was published in 2006, and in the years between then and now, I've regularly made notes in a file that I called Gretel's Story. It was a book I hoped to write one day, telling the story of Bruno's older sister, Gretel, who, at the end of her life, looks back at the experience she was part of and is forced to examine her conscience regarding her guilt and complicity in those times. Eventually, Gretel's story became All the Broken Places, a novel that begins in 1946 Paris, moves to Sydney in the 50s, and ends in 2022 London, when Gretel is 91 years old, but still struggling with her memories and her conscience.
Thank you. So The Family Remains is a sequel to The Family Upstairs. And it's possibly an unexpected jumping off point from where The Family Upstairs ended, in as much as Family Remains actually starts with a character called Rachel, who is the wife of Michael, who dies in the first novel. So we're looking at quite a few different threads, and Rachel's is one of them. She wakes up to a phone call from the maid in on tea telling her that her husband's body has been found in the basement. We also revisit Henry, who is off on his mission to find Finn now that Finn's finally been tracked down. But he goes off on an unexpected tangent as well, maybe not what the reader of The Family Upstairs might be expecting. And we also come back to Lucy, who is trying to put down roots, having had this very sort of transient lifestyle for so many years, wants to buy a house and finally set up home with her children, but something knocks that plan completely off the rails, and she finds herself on the run again. And interwoven with these three main storylines, I also have a detective called Samuel who's found a bag of bones on the shores of the River Thames. And the bag of bones turn out to belong to a young woman called Birdie Dunlop Evers.
When Rome flashes its eyes, visitors fall silent. Frescoes, marble apostles, candles in basilicas. But murder is part of the picture too, as is the legacy of a man who kept hope alight. The story of Monsignor Hugh O'Flaherty's heroism during the Second World War is a thriller. Born in Republican North Cork, brought up in Kerry, he came of age around the mistrust of England left by the Black and Tans. But his journey saw him live by his own moral code, even in the face of mortal danger and at the risk of being ostracized by his Vatican superiors. In hiding escaped Allied prisoners and Rome's Jews from the Nazis, O'Flaherty revealed himself as a man who wouldn't be bullied by anyone, friend or enemy. He and a small band of colorful associates helped 6,000 people to freedom. It's a tale of borders and boundaries, how the Nazis painted a white line around Vatican City to keep him inside, but he defied them, risking everything for what was right. He was brave, cunning, and most of all, stubborn. My father's house celebrates his achievement.
I'm Robin Stevens, the author of the Murdermost Unladylike Mysteries series, and I'm delighted to be introducing you to my new book, The Ministry of Unladylike Activity. Ministry takes place in 1940 and stars Mae Wong, the little sister of Hazel Wong, as well as two entirely new detective characters, one of whom happens to be half Irish. It's a country house murder mystery, it's a spy story, it's a story about the parts of World War II that are talked about a little bit less, and it's a story about friendship. I'm hoping it's going to appeal to my existing fans as well as to pull in an entirely new generation of detective readers. It's been 8 years since Murder Most Unladylike was first published, and I can't tell you how grateful and thrilled I am that you have all worked so hard to make Murder Most Unladylike such a huge success in Ireland. I have legions of Irish fans, and I am just so thrilled about that. I'm really hoping that you will take Ministry of Unladylike Activity to your hearts in the same way and help make it another huge success. Thank you so much for all the amazing work you've already done, and I can't wait to hear what you think about the new book.
Hello to Irish booksellers and readers. I'm Karen M. McManus. I write young adult thrillers, including the One of Us is Lying series, and standalones like Two Can Keep a Secret, The Cousins, and You'll Be the Death of Me. My latest book is a standalone called Nothing More to Tell. This is the gorgeous UK proof. It's going to be hitting shelves in Ireland in September 2022, and it is the story of a teen journalist who investigates the cold case murder of her favorite teacher, whose body was found by her ex-best friend turned nemesis.
So I hope you're all having a great night. We hope everyone's having a great night at the Penguin Party. We wanted to just have a little check-in and to say thanks so much to everyone for all of your support, in particular all the booksellers over the last year. It's just been incredible. I mean, if you said to us a year ago, we have a number one best-selling book. What was the name of our number one best-selling book?
A Hug for You.
A Hug for You. And that we pick up an Irish Book Award, we would have laughed at you. We can't believe it. Obviously, we're so grateful to everyone at Penguin as well. Thank you so much. But we have some exciting news, don't we?
Yeah.
What are we going to do this year?
It's all over again.
We're going to do it all over again because we have a new book coming out. Tell the gang what's the name of our new book.
Sir Adam the Brave and the Moody Monsters.
So there's some moody monsters that are wrecking the king, the magical kingdom of Wampy, and in steps the most brave and bright and wonderful knight, Sir Adam the Brave, and he saves the day, don't you?
Yeah.
Of course he does. Virtual hug for everybody. Take care. Bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Hello, Ireland. I'm Ben McIntyre, and I want to tell you about my new book, Colditz, Prisoners of the Castle. Now, we all think we know the story of Colditz because it's embedded in our national identity, really. It's a story of black and white heroism, brave soldiers digging their way out of the castle. And of course, there are incredible escape stories within Colditz, many of them, and episodes of astonishing courage. But the real story of Colditz is a lot more complicated than that, and in some ways, a lot darker. It's also much funnier. There are elements of great tragedy, but also extraordinary comedy inside Colditz. And I discovered it's really a story, at some levels, about class and race and sexuality and many of the things that we're fascinated by today, but which half a century ago were not things that people really talked about.
All the facts and stories in this book are unnerving enough individually, but they too are closely joined together, just like all of us. And once you start to connect them, understanding them as part of a web of interlinked events, they quickly gain another, far more alarming meaning. Who is responsible for piecing together that greater holistic tale? Who do we call upon when it comes to addressing the whole picture? The answer is no one, or rather, everyone.
The last mile is never crowded. That's the way it does feel sometimes. It does feel very lonely, but I suppose that's the difference, isn't it? You know, to be able to hold on in there and keep it going.
When
in red from Ireland, Kelly Harrington.
Hold your head up high and don't be afraid.
She's risen to every single challenge so far, Kelly Harrington. She's going to need to be almost perfect.
There's a goal.
A lot of work still to do in the second round. Needs to try and level it up. Two absolute warriors in there. There's the bell. What a performance. Is it enough for the gold medal?
Whoa.
She's done it. Olympic champion, Kelly Harrington. Gold for the darling of Dublin, Michael Caruth, Katie Taylor, and now Kelly Harrington. Champion.
This time, I really, really feel the whole country is behind me.
Soak it all in. Olympic champion, Kelly Harrington.
And you'll never walk alone.
Hakuna Matata.
My name is Suad Aldara. I'm a data scientist and engineer and also a writer. My book is the story of my life, searching for belonging. I am Syrian, but I grew up in Saudi Arabia, where I learned to cover up from a young age. I wrote this book to tell an authentic story about Syria, in hope to change the negative narrative around us. This story is not about war and camps. It's a window into what life looked like in my beloved home, Syria. It's the story about the aftermath of war, about paper borders, and what it takes to build a life out of the rubble and make peace with it.
Hi everybody. Unfortunately, I can't be with you there tonight. To my friends on Penguin, Michael, Brendan, Louise, and the main man himself, Paul Howard. To all you booksellers and media, I'd like to apologise for not being there, but I'll be just telling lies to be honest with you. The Rodfather, Roddy Collins here, the Rodfather, AKA, I've been called a few names over the years, but this is the new one. Anyway, I hope you enjoy the book. It's a story of stories of my life, from a four-year-old who made a subconscious decision that a 30 wasn't for me. So I marched off into the world, telling my father I was going to be the next middleweight champion. Anyway, as you get through the book, you will realise that was going pear-shaped. I entered with my skills of empathy, love, streetwise education. That wasn't going well until 16 years of age when I met the love of my life, Caroline, and together we marched on. I found my love for football and entered into the murky world. I would call it the viper's nest of professional football. And through that journey, there's been many ups and downs, highs and lows, sadness, elation, everything you can ever imagine, every emotion. And I would never have been able to express this only for the expertise of Paul Howard. So we sat down for 12 months, we worked really hard, and we put it all down on paper. I hope you find it enjoyable. If you find it half as funny as I did sitting down with Paul every week, well, that'll be one good outcome. Hopefully the media will be fair with it, and hopefully the booksellers will fly off the shelf for you. Just one thing before I go. Paul Howard, a scone goes in the microwave for 40 seconds, not 4 minutes. Hope that's one thing you learn from visiting my house. Hey, let's go.